We're fortunate to have Dr. Subramanian Swamy from India, well-known practitioner, and very intelligent person, knows a lot. I want to have his presence. And, of course, Dr. Koenraad, Elst from Belgium, who last decades has been working on these issues. For both of you, I can ask, a number of questions were raised about Indian media, but, for example, Iran's got Press TV, Russia's got RT, BBC, well-known. What is stopping India from having its own similar media channel? They say it costs money, but how much money is being lost already? But then that would improve the image of the country, would it not? To give a more balanced perspective, having a media channel in English, which the world could then listen to.
Well, I mean, it's easier said than done. In 2010, when I was on a long tour, speaking engagement in the United States, all our people said the same thing, and I raised the same question, where's the money going to come from? They said, how much do you need? I said, I need 20 crores. Most people ask for 100, 200 to start it, but I felt that I would be able to get it moving. So they did not give. I said, I'll start it, and then you start sending the money. And I had government clearance on receiving checks from abroad under what is called the Foreign Contribution Regulation Act. So I started the TV and got all the licenses, and I also put in 20 million rupees of my own money, and then I found nobody was sending, or they were sending piffling amounts. They told me that what is 20 crores? That's something like $300,000 or something, $3 million, and we'll give it to you. That's not a big deal, but not a penny came. So that's been the experience of others. We have an independent channel called Sundarshan TV, but unfortunately, he's literally reduced to scraping the bottom of the barrel. So I don't know where this money is going to come from. You say, does the government feel the urge? I don't know. The government has so far not felt the urge, because the media doesn't attack any minister. It attacks a low-level minister who is part of the lumpen crowd. You see, but the key ministers, the powerful ministers, it doesn't touch. So they don't feel the heat, and so the government is not motivated to chip in and see that such a channel starts. But in principle, I'm in agreement with you. We need a channel like that, and the first opportunity, I'll do it again.
Well, the government is perhaps not conscious of its need for such a channel. But I think there are very good, compelling reasons for India as a nation to have such a channel, and therefore for the Modi government to take up that issue. And so, you see, in terms of money, it is really nothing, you see, if you have the money. And, you know, if Hindu money bags don't come forward, you know, that is an issue that the government as such might take up and should take up. You know, imagine that there was such a channel in 2002, and you see all the other media were attacking Modi, but this channel could paint the true picture. You know, that would have made a big difference. And you see, Modi is still under attack. You see, maybe in India you notice it a bit less right now. Internationally,
yes,
there still is a hate Modi brigade. So I think it really deserves to be taken up. And, you know, in this case, I'm a bit disappointed in rich Hindus that they're not getting serious about it.
Yeah.
Because they are financing things. It's not that they're so greedy, but you know, they are financing, for example, the Sanskrit translators led by Sheldon Pollock. You know, they are financing the enemy side. You know, as long as it has something to do with India, they feel flattered, and then they come forward with their money. So you see, there's a little bit of consciousness needed. And then you see they should realize the need for this.
Now, one of the problems would be if the government got involved, then who will control the TV will become a factor. Mm-hmm. Who are the people? So there are people who would not want me, because I would perhaps run an independent television, the true sense of the word. So therefore they'll say, no, with him we don't know when he's going to shoot us. So I in order to maintain credibility, I must say I like it is, you see. So that's the way why I say that if the private individuals give the money, it can be done. But now I can't start the same way which I started last time on faith. Now I must have it up front.
Speaking of private nations and independent thought, why is there yet really no Hindu think tank?
Why do we have
no Hindu think tank? Give other religious bodies have it.
Same argument. I have set up a Hindu think tank called Center for National Renaissance. I don't get any money at all.
Right.
Dr. Swamy, why is in India, like a professional Hindu academic institution?
Yes.
There is not even one. Why are Hindus, if you're going to dismantle the enemy, you've got to know how to take him down.
No, we know what to do. The issue is that if I go to any industrialist, he says, listen, for your politics, I'm willing to give you as much money as you want. But this one is a bottomless hole. I don't want to get into this. And you shouldn't be spending your time on this. That's what the advice they've given me, the really rich industrialists. Now, if I give it, ask the government to do it, then it will be another form of mainstream media, see.
That argument is reminiscent of the argument of the enemies of Margaret Thatcher, who summarized her viewpoints with the proverb, investing more in eggs and less in chicken. You see, thought is very important, but it works in the long run.
Yeah.
So, if you invest in it, you don't see immediate results.
Yes.
So that's why business people tend to see it as a loss.
But the thing is, I personally think Hindus are a little bit lazy, so...
It's not lazy. I'm telling you, it's not lazy. They're not sure. Supposing BJP lasts another 4 years without difficulty and looks as if they're going to come back to power, I'll have no problem setting up a budget. Today they're worried that if we don't come back to power, because they just come in, no? So they're not sure about how will it all go. And after the Delhi election, they've got a little bit of a fright, the rich people. The public can react like this, and bring some riffraff into power. So they would say, then we'll be targeted. Now, if we take money in black, then we are also running the risk. If I take money in cash, which they're ready to give, but then I can't run a channel. I'll be, a victim of somebody filing a court case. You don't have to have the government hostile to you. Somebody can go to the court and file a case.
But of course, if the BJP is returned to power, then the atmosphere becomes more comfortable.
Yes, that's right.
And at the moment, many so-called secularists still swear by secularism because the BJP, in a sense, is still in the opposition. Ideologically, they still don't control the atmosphere. And so if they are returned to power, then the power equation really changes. But because, many secularists really are opportunists. And right now it's fashionable to be secularists, so that's what they are. But some people cross over, like it has already been done by MJ Akbar.
Yes.
Who started working for the BJP. And so media people will do so on a large scale once they are really sure that the atmosphere has changed.
In terms of going for NGO, you mentioned about not filing their sort of finances. The impression you get from the outside, or they try to give Western media, is that India is so poor, it needs these Christian missionaries to go there to help it, we have no hospitals, we have no schools. But there are many Hindu voluntary groups, Sai Baba for example, just to mention one, who do run hospitals.
But who does it impact, this kind of propaganda? It doesn't. You see, when you're sitting abroad, yes, it looks bad. But in India, it has no... I will tell you, for all the talk of conversion, leaving aside the state of Andhra Pradesh, they are literally on the slide down. In Tamil Nadu, they had great hopes. Now people are going the opposite direction. And wherever these conversions take place, they are taking in twos, threes, tens, that's all, per month. Now, that in this huge population is a drop in the bucket. Now, over the period of time, even that will stop. Because they won't get any great advantage being a Christian. Because these are all induced conversions. Okay? So, I agree with you that at the foreign level, we are getting a real bashing. But I have not found this as having had an impact on our people.
Right, and the conversion drive, you know, seems strong looking at from the outside. But you see, among the Indian common people, first of all, the conversions, if they take place, are not very deep. And so it's easy to affect the so-called ghar wapasi,
yes,
a homecoming. And so you see, more of this is happening than we realize. Secondly, from the Christian angle, you see, they foresee that conversion is fruitful in the long run. You see, these superficial conversions, you know, they don't take it very seriously, but as long as they send their children to Christian schools, the next generation will already have a real grounding in Christianity. So that's, you know, what the missionaries count on. But you see, as long as conversion is only superficial, people can easily come back. Now, right now, the Modi government, you see, even though it doesn't do many pro-Hindu things, you know, even though many Hindu workers for the parties feel disappointed, nevertheless, it creates a pro-Hindu atmosphere.
Yeah.
And so people are much less likely to feel that it's useful to convert.
Right.
Yeah.
Soon after, when the BJP government came in, we saw it in the media, the whole thing about the Kharvapsi project. It was quite in the forefront, happening quite en masse. It lasted, well, at least in terms of the media, its presence lasted for a very short time. Is it still going on quite solidly, or was it just the excitement of the initial entrance of Modi into position?
No, there were three dimensions to this governance idea. You're asking about the election results, no?
About the Kharvapsi.
Oh, Kharvapsi, that's going on, Simon.
It's still going.
Yeah, but that has already been going on for a long time. It was suddenly a media event.
Yeah.
You know, partly because the media needed something, anything to embarrass the Modi government, partly because of the coincidence that, you see, one person who organized the Ghar Wapasi, you know, had a bit of an ego and, you know, tried to create publicity for himself.
That's right. Correct.
Just one.
The right one.
About secularism. Okay. Is secularism even irrelevant to...
Yeah, is secularism relevant to India? Because, I mean, I'm sure you read Dr. Elst was one of them. It came out of the 30s war in Europe. Catholics and Protestants wiping each other out. Doesn't even apply to India. You don't have a profane and sacred modernistic.
It's a word which is, he is a person who has done a lot of work on this kind of thing. But it's a word which has only appealed to English speaking people. We are a nation which believes in plurality. Okay, we know that there are differences and we learn to cope with it and live with it. But to say that we'll have nothing to do with religion, like we would not light an inauguration ceremony with a lamp or break a coconut, that kind of thing the people won't accept. And in our new government, even if we don't do anything, the atmosphere is such that people go ahead and do it.
Secularism originated in Europe, and it was to a large extent applied by the British when they were faced with the Hindu-Muslim problem. And so it is from concern with that problem that then Nehru inherited the notion of what he called secularism, which was already a bit different from what the British applied, which was very different from what existed in Europe. And you see, from a Hindu viewpoint, it's a concept that you don't need at all, because, you know, pluralism, live and let live, that already existed. You know, they didn't need to have that brought from anywhere else.
Right.
Can I just ask you both one last question?
Yes.
What do you think of Facebook Hindus? You know, there's so many both of people.
Oh, yeah. That is the new hope for India.
Yeah.
Twitter and Facebook.
Yeah.
Indians are the very Indians whom I would like first to mentally equip. Mm-hmm. What do you mean by Hindutva? How do I try to achieve those milestones in Hindutva? And for that purpose, I've started a separate organization called Virat Hindustan Sangam, where we teach people that if you want to build a round temple, what's the legal way of doing it? Mm. Or if you want to remove Article 370, what's the legal way of doing it? Or what do we need to do to get the Uniform Civil Code implemented? So I think the internet crowd or the online crowd is really vital, because they are fierce and they are articulate, and if properly educated in this arena, in this area, they are going to be a totally different, they are going to be catalytic in the election, in the politics in the country.
The first generation of so-called internet Hindus was still very primitive in its approach.
Yeah.
And they, you know, for instance, something that I've read hundreds of times is, oh, the solution is declaring a Hindu Rashtra. No, I mean, that is really what is not a solution.
Yeah.
So that's pure symbol politics. You create a lot of enemies simply by declaring a Hindu Rashtra, and you achieve nothing. It makes no difference. Now, see, today with everybody being on social media, you do find a churning, you know, a thinking process going on. And it's a very good medium for Hindus. And here I'm going to borrow something rather unkind that Rajiv Malhotra said. I mean, as a non-Hindu, I wouldn't dare to bring it up myself, but I can quote a Hindu on it. You see, the people that he deals with who want to do something for Hinduism, at the same time, are a bit mentally lazy. You see, very active in social life, in working life, but, you know, they don't put any intellectual effort into it. Now, for them, the social media are perfect.
Yeah.
You know, you get these sound bites.
Yes.
You know, everything is put in a few sentences.
Yes.
And that way, ideas get conveyed.
Yes.
Back then, you know, in the 90s, when Sitaram Goel would write a book, you know, the first thing that the RSS people would say is, but can't you reduce that to a brochure? Now, in a way, you see, I understand that. You know, many people in India like, you know, are sensible to ideas, but you see, don't like to put too much time into it. Well, okay, you see, for that audience that is really there, you have the social media, and they function perfectly, and they greatly helped in achieving the election victory of Narendra Modi.
The kind of people who came today, 20 years ago, would be that. There will be blue collar people from South Hall. I mean, these are people who, you know, have value for time.
Yeah.
And they came and they sat through the whole thing. They were enthusiastic. That's the new thing that I've witnessed all over the country.
We started in the 90s ourselves. I mean,
yeah.
We're the original internet.
Yeah.
So we've done massive campaigns. So we know the effect of it. But
that's,
we also know that you have to follow it by action. So
Then
you definitely can achieve something.
That's right. No, first you must know what to do.
Yeah.
And that you have to prepare their mindset. Yeah. Then let's do it.
Yeah, yeah.
Not just simply, you know,
We take on missionaries and they run from us, they ban us. John Dell's blacked our Twitter account. He won't speak to us.
Yeah, we've taken them to live debates.
Yeah, I know.
Once they're taken in a live debate, that's it, the whole thing collapses. Hindus need to do that in India as well. It's like bring them on camera and debate their ideas and things and that, and you'll see the copy collapse.
In India, we don't need, because the broad masses are with us. And these crowds doesn't matter to us.
Yeah.
I won't waste time. I just go to TV just to have some fun.
Yeah, but everybody's scared of you though.
Yeah, because I got arguments they can't answer. Why they my lecture at Harvard University and Oxford were cancelled?
Yeah, yeah.
Because of the fact that you are unable to respond.
Yeah,
so you shut him out.
Yeah, yeah. But I know that in the long run that's going to turn against us.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Because we have got the young, bright guys who, you know, who can articulate, and we only have to prepare them, you know, polish them up, and then we've got it made, a revolution is made.
So what do you think about, one last question, what do you think about the government so far, BJP government so far?
Well, they've had a difficult time because, you see, I think somebody planted this idea into Modi because Modi spoke to me about it. he doesn't want to rock the boat in the first year. But I told him it's a mistake. In fact, I'm not in the government because I'll rock the boat.
Yeah.
I'll put some people in jail. There will be a parliament will be, there will be protest demonstrations in the parliament, you know that. So he told me he wanted to go, but now that's a mistake. Many of the people who should have been replaced, like the governor of the Reserve Bank or the Secretary of Finance, all the same people are continuing. So the thing that now we have to work, and which was discussed in our national executive, which I couldn't attend, was that, all right, fine, you may have put the so-called elite on get them relaxed, but our workers are saying nothing is happening, and they won't wait very long, and they don't have to go against the party, they just don't have to go come out of their houses, which some people say happened in Delhi. Okay, so that's where I think you will find in the next 2 months Modi will do something. At least to get a different kind of cabinet.
Yes, you know, he should nominate the right people to prepare certain things.
I know, and you know, decent place also.
There are fairly easy issues like this Article 30 that are very important. The one that you see disadvantages Hinduism in matters of education.
Article 30 have come over to your point of view.
So you see, there they could start some action. Maybe it will take time to really get something on the rails, but precisely that is the reason to start now. Not to let it wait. And so they should also, I understand that they want to be careful not to offend the minorities. Well, there are a number of issues very important for Hindus that don't offend the minorities, that don't take any rights away from them.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.